Welcome. What a special pleasure. And I almost feel like closing the Bible and sitting down. Amen. We have a hero that we've been speaking about in our Bible teachings for the last 2 months. Unfortunately, this hero knew less about Jesus coming as a baby than we do. If you remember, Peter, our hero, did not have access to the Gospels at the time that he was living. He did follow Jesus, but that was when he was a young man. There was a whole part of his life that Jesus may not have told Peter. Peter may have met some of the shepherds that were there that night that we sing about, but then again, maybe not. Did Peter ever have an interview with Jesus' parents, Mary and Joseph? We don't know. Given Jesus' nature, he wasn't one to brag a lot about his past performance. So we actually have no idea how much Peter knew, but I am going to guess that even some of our children may know more about the details when Jesus came as a baby than Peter did. However, today we are going to find that Peter knew something about Jesus that was spectacular and has relevance to our Christmas season and our focus on Jesus Christ as our glorious Messiah. And so I'd like to ask Denise to read our key text. And if you have your Bibles, please open them. Cell phones are fine if you'd like to follow along. I don't have all the texts here, but our key text we have. Denise, please.
For we did not follow cleverly devised stories when we told you about the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ in power, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty.
You know the context of this, the story. They're on a mountain. It's possible the mountain was about 9,200 feet high. Mount Hermon is the one that most theologians think is the mountain. So they had some climbing to do. Those of you that are mountain climbers, 9,000 feet, especially when you're starting at sea level, where the Dead Sea is a significant climb. This didn't just happen in an hour. They had been on this journey, just the three of them, Peter, James, and John, with Jesus, climbing. What they talked about, I don't know. Probably they just spent time grunting and breathlessly going up. They were in good shape, but I don't think that they were used to a lot of altitude. So here they are climbing this mountain. They get to the top. They see something amazing, which we're going to unpack in a few minutes. And Peter says to us today, no, I wasn't there when Jesus was born. I didn't hear the angels sing, but I can tell you that I am not following a cleverly devised story when I talk to you in my letters about the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ in his power. And particularly, he said, he claimed, I was an eyewitness of his majesty. Well, what famous cleverly devised stories do you know about someone's arrival? Cleverly devised stories, in other words, not true, about someone who arrived. Do you know any stories like that? Are there any famous ones? Santa Claus is one. Any others? Just for those of you that didn't get a chance, because my bright student is here on the front row. Any other stories that we know aren't really true, but we talk about them as if somebody is coming? The stork, yes. Oh my goodness, the storks. Can you imagine our teenagers, how they would laugh at us if they heard that? Any others? Peter Cottontail. Okay, so now you've got the idea. Peter is drawing upon, and there were cleverly devised stories back then, and he's saying, guess what? I'm not talking about Santa Claus or Peter Cottontail or storks. What I have to tell you, I saw with my own eyes. So, I'd like to identify just a few of those cleverly designed stories of the day. These were stories that of people, okay, that happened in his generation. So what you can't see is Judas, the son of Hezekiah. He claimed to be a Messiah. Simon of Perea, Athronges, the shepherd, Judas, the Galilean, the Samaritan prophet, King Herod Agrippa. There is some evidence in history that he saw himself to be the Messiah. Theudas and the Egyptian prophet. Eight clever Messiah stories that were circulating at the time that Peter wrote this epistle to his people. Well, it happened a few years ago when I was just a little boy growing up in Peshawar, in Pakistan. There you see me. I heard from my mom that in a week, Queen Elizabeth was coming to our town. The year was 1961. And I said, next Sunday she's coming? And my mama said, yes. And in fact, we've heard that she's going to worship at the Church of England, which was the property adjacent to the Seventh-day Adventist mission. It was literally a stone's throw away from my house. And I determined that at all costs I would be there. And I said, Mom, can we go? And Mom said, I'm sorry, we haven't been invited and we know the church will be packed. And so I started making my plans. I decided I was going to see the Queen at all costs. And I knew the area very well. It was my next door neighbor's place. I knew all the little boys that ran around there, the servant boys, and we used to play football, soccer together every morning. And so we found a tree overlooking the entrance to the Church of England, which was later changed to the Church of Pakistan. And a couple of us climbed that tree and got camouflaged well before she was to arrive. And there we waited patiently until the time rolled around on Sunday morning. The entourage came, she got out of the limousine, people were there to greet her. And I remember distinctly to this day exactly where I was sitting in the tree, and I remember exactly what she was wearing. Yes, it was a pink outfit with a pink hat. She looked like she belonged on a birthday cake, as far as I was concerned. So that's as close as I have gotten to the splendor of a king or queen. That's as close. That's an eyewitness account. Have any of you been close to someone famous that you would say has glory and splendor? Yes, so. President Kennedy. So here's some, those of you that do, you want to sit at the table today during our meal together. And hear some of those stories. What is it like to be close to this grand, powerful person and maybe a stone's throw or spitting distance, as a little boy would say, to this great person? Peter said it in our key text.
Peter climbed a mountain to see his monarch. Some scholars think the mountain was Mount Hermon.
But Peter never claimed to be an eyewitness of His Majesty's glorious birth in Bethlehem. And Peter never claimed to be an eyewitness of His Majesty's dramatic baptism in the Jordan. But Peter did claim that he saw his rabbi change from a homeless man into a majestic Messiah on a mountaintop. He never forgot what Matthew described in his description found in Matthew 17, 2. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light.
What happened? Let's ask Merriam-Webster. To give a new and typically exalted spiritual appearance to transform outwardly and usually for the better. This is the definition of transfigure.
Transform. Some of you know about transformers. Some of you know about human beings that are walking along. I think there are some movies and books. They're walking along, and you'd think they're just human beings, and all of a sudden they transform into superheroes. You know about that, right? So if there was ever a moment when Jesus transformed or was transfigured into a superhero, it was at the top of this mountain. So I have a few questions. Why did Jesus need to be transformed? Wasn't his spiritual condition already pure and holy? Wasn't he already a superhero? The Bible says,
just then there appeared before them Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. Can you imagine what that conversation meant to Jesus? These men represented the law and the prophets. They were given the assignment to hold up the hands of the one who would fulfill the law and be the greatest of all prophets.
So here was Moses. He was the brilliant leader of 2 million rebellious slaves who took 40 years to do a trek that should have taken 3 months. He sacrificed his career and his life to cross the Jordan River. That was his whole goal. Take his team, his group, and cross that river into the promised land. But he utterly failed in his life work. He never was able to cross the river. He could see that river from the top of the mountain, snaking through the arid valley. But he knew, Moses knew what it was like to drink from a bitter cup and die alone. After almost succeeding in his goals and achieving the dream that God gave to him. So here is Moses, and he's holding up the hand of Jesus. I think he has the experience. I think he has gone through enough of the pain and sorrow, so much so that Jesus chose him to co-write the greatest pop song ever in the universe. You know what the name of the song is? It's the song of Moses and the Lamb. There is no other human being that co-writes a song with Jesus like that. And there's a reason for it. Great Moses, feeling absolutely frustrated, dying alone, thinking that he had totally messed up. And yet there he was, on top of that mountain, holding up one of Jesus' hands. And now the other person is Elijah. Elijah, well, he's a charismatic leader of the school of the prophets. He was Elisha's mentor. He was a suicidal marathon runner. He was a faith healer, a crow food eater, death defier, a chariot rider. Elijah was translated pretty close to being transfigured, wouldn't you say? I suspect the experience that he had with major depression, remember, after the awesome God giving the rain, he stood unflinchingly in front of King Ahab, then he ran down, guiding the horses down, and then kept on running because he was scared of Queen Jezebel. He couldn't stand up to her. and went into this deep, dark funk in a river, so depressed that he couldn't eat, he couldn't sleep, he was scared, and yet he had experienced the miraculous power of God. If anybody knew that he could be triumphant with God on his side, Elijah did. But he was a human being. And I believe that he exhibited the signs of major clinical depression. What a guy to be there a few weeks before Jesus would go to the Garden of Gethsemane and beg for a way out. The sweating of the great drops of blood, a sign that our Savior was spiraling down into depression. And God knew that Elijah should be the guy to hold up his other hand. Now, the answer to my question, why did Jesus need to be transfigured? Wasn't he already a superhero? He'd fed the 5,000. He'd turned the water into wine, grape juice, however you want to interpret that, okay? He had raised people from the dead. He had done these great things. He was already a superhero. Why did he need to climb 9,000 feet in the air and have two people support him when he was already pure? He did not need salvation. Do you agree with me? Jesus Christ did not need salvation. This was not a come to God moment. This was not an evangelistic appeal. Come down here and accept a salvation. He was salvation. But he needed something, my brothers and sisters, something that we all share with Jesus today. He needed affirmation. He needed a shot in each arm. And God, his Father, knew what he needed and provided for him the two people that would be able to give him the shot in each arm. Frankly, his disciples, Peter, James, and John, his closest friends, had neither the capacity nor the inclination to offer what Jesus needed on that mountain. And so God had to access some other people. Don't be surprised when God brings someone into your life that you never expected, who end up giving you, lifting you, bringing you where God wants you to be. Praise God for this. And I want to then point your attention to 2 Peter 1:17.
He received honor and glory from God the Father when the voice came to him from the majestic glory, saying, "This is my Son whom I love. With him I am well pleased."
In addition to the affirmation of other human beings, Jesus needed to hear that he was respected and loved by the one who was his closest friend, his Father. I don't have to preach a sermon, parents. Oasis stands as a lighthouse in our community. To the parents who have neglected this principle, somehow either they're incapable of or have chosen not to communicate respect and love for their kids. And so they come to you. Bless you and your team. And shame, a little shame on us. As the body of Jesus, we need to somehow find a way to collaborate, to team with, and to actually make a difference in the lives of these kids whose parents were unwilling or unable to communicate respect and love at a time they needed it. And if there was any time that Jesus needed to hear his Father, he had already heard his Father at his baptism say, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." It's less than 3 years We know it's just a few weeks before he's going to go through the Passion. But Jesus needed to hear it, but there's something else. Not only did Jesus need this experience, Peter needed to see it with his own eyes. Now, if you read on, and we don't have time to go there, if you read on in Matthew, you will find that Peter, impetuous guy that he is, always wanting to do something, immediately said to Jesus after this, well, first of all, when God said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased," he also said, "Listen to him." Interesting. Told the three, "Listen to him." And they were down on their faces. The glory of the Lord was all around them. They couldn't stand it. Peter gets up and says, "Jesus, let me build three houses, three little huts here, okay? Three little tents on the top of this mountain, three little places where anyone else who ever climbs this place will see that Moses," of course the buzz will be down there, "Moses and Elijah and Jesus were all here." It's interesting to note, and I don't know, I don't make too much of this, but you would think Peter would say, okay, this is all about Jesus. This is all about Jesus. The other two guys are there to do what I couldn't do. There should be one hut, right? But he makes three. That's interesting. That's interesting. But no need. No need to build an edifice. No need to build an institution out of this moment. Only to observe the splendor and the majesty of His Highness, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Would you sing with me an old song, and we'll help you with the words. It's a great old song. Some of you will know this.
Oh, what a wonderful,
wonderful day.
Day I shall never forget.
Day I shall never forget. After I wandered in darkness away,
Jesus my Savior
I met. Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend.
He met the need
of my heart. Shadows dispelling with joy, I am telling, He made all the darkness depart.
Heaven came down in glory.
Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross my Savior made me whole, my sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul.
Praise you, man. Had you been there, you could have sung this song all the way down that mountain. Can you just imagine what it would have been like? What you had to say when you got down there to where the people were? What you had experienced? Can you imagine? You had personally been an eyewitness to the splendor and the glory of God. Now, theologians will argue, and I have no way of knowing the truth. I read enough this week, however, to understand that there is a legitimate argument. Some argue that what happened to Jesus happened from the inside out. You remember he raised himself from the dead? The Bible teaches us this. Okay, from the power that was already there. So it could be that the kingly power was just covered like a tent, and at that moment at the top, the what was already there in Jesus just came out for a little glimpse of his disciples to see, which was okay because, you know, they'd been walking around, and he was a great guy, but he was dirty and he had, you know, sandals, and he was just a guy. He was an amazing guy. He was a guru. He was a teacher. He was a rabbi. But he was just one of the guys. a man among men. There are other theologians that say, no, this was a special divine light, a spotlight that came from heaven, that was a residual of his kingly authority, which he left when he came to this world. Either way, what happened on the top of that mountain was the real deal. It was the real Jesus. It was the Jesus that most people did not see. And it was the Jesus that Peter needed to see desperately. And we do too. Have you seen his glory? Peace on earth. Goodwill to men. Have you seen his glory? Have you experienced it? I want to close with just a couple stories. Bethany Hamilton, Google her. Look her up. She's the Christian girl that was a world-class surfer. And a few years ago, while surfing, she was engaged in a shark attack, and the shark just took her arm from the shoulder down. People said, she's been lucky to be alive. She actually swam to shore, paddled to shore with her surfboard. She was determined from day one to become a championship surfer again. Now, how do you do that? How many of you have surfed? Okay. How do you catch a wave with only one hand? I mean, it's hard enough for those of us that have barely surfed to catch a wave with two hands going as fast as we can. She learned to do it. And if you take time to read and watch her story this afternoon, kids, you will be shocked. Do you know what she ascribes her strength to, her courage to? Her name, Bethany Hamilton. It was her faith in God. She saw something about God's glory that the rest of her family and friends did not see. She absolutely believed that there was power available to her that nobody knew existed. And then there's someone else, and her name is Lizzie Velasquez. Lizzie was born, and if you look her up, be prepared. Parents, you need to look it up on behalf of your kids. Some of the most cruel words on Facebook and YouTube. She is known as the most ugly person, most ugly woman in the world. Look her up. Lizzie Velasquez. When her mother saw what was being written about her, she contacted those who had put it up, begged them to take it off, and they said, no way. She's a freak. She was born with a congenital disease, and that disease basically means that you can't lay down fat. The food that you take that is supposed to give you the necessary fats that you need, most of us would wish that maybe we had a little touch of that disease, but here it is. She could not lay down fat, so the disease is called adipose something, which means her body was incapable of manufacturing fat. And so she's this thin, gaunt woman with big eyes. And if you just look at her, you don't see anything beautiful. Now, none of us should call someone ugly. My mother taught me that. I had spankings over that. But still, the truth is, she's not beautiful as we define beauty. She's not. She's the farthest from that. And yet, Lizzie wears a little necklace with a little cross on it. She prays. She believes. She is now one of the most sought-after motivational speakers. When you go home and you look in the mirror today, and you kind of, you know, you do know there is always someone who doesn't look quite as good as you do. Have you ever noticed on the escalator, when there are mirrors, people going up and down an escalator. Next time you do and you see mirrors on the side, just check out how many people take a look at themselves. I mean, it's not like they didn't check it out before they left home. We are consumed by how we look and how we appear to others today. With Peter, would you take a glimpse of the King of Kings? Would you let his radiance transform you from the inside out? You can be a superhero too. You can have a mount of transfiguration as Jesus did. And there will be people who will come beside you and hold up your hands and tell you, you're precious. As Lizzie did, she believed the truth that Jesus knew about her and her parents knew about her. She was a beautiful soul, maybe the most beautiful woman in the world. But most of us would not see it. Today, may God give you the eyes, the eyes. We know about the Christmas story. We know about the baptism of Jesus. But I pray that God will give you the eyes of Peter on the mountain to see the transfigured Jesus and allow the great God of heaven to come into you.
King of kings and Lord of lords, glory, alleluia.
King of kings and Lord of lords, glory, alleluia. Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, alleluia. Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, alleluia.
One more time, Denise, take it with the ladies, okay?
King of kings and Lord of lords, glory, alleluia.
King of kings and Lord of lords, glory, alleluia.
Together.
Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, alleluia. Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, alleluia.
Amen. And now may the great God, the God of love, the great God who has created us, and may the Spirit of God, the God who lives inside and transforms us and gives us victory in Jesus, and the God who has chosen to live as a human being, but once in a while, the brilliance of heaven flashed through. And we with Peter say we are eyewitnesses. Oh, Jesus, for your forgiveness and for your power to give us compassion and forgiveness for those who hurt us and seek to say evil things against us. Oh, God, we thank you. And may the God of all peace go with you now and forevermore. Amen.